YouTube channels. We are at 7:01. I see 16 people on. Hopefully everyone sees in the chat the link to sign in. Hold on, my computer is slow. Okay, good. The delay happened. All right. Hello and welcome, everyone. I am Sunshine with Outdoor Chattanooga. Outdoor Chattanooga is a division of the City of Chattanooga. Our role is to promote all things outdoors within the scenic city and encourage people to get outside and play. During COVID, we taught ourselves how to use technology in order to continue to engage with our community and offer our typical classroom-based workshops in order to continue to serve you guys and teach outdoor skills. So they did so well, we decided to keep it rolling all year long. So about once a month, we're going to teach a new skill. And our awesome intern, Robert, is an avid rock climber. So we recruited him to help teach a workshop all about rock climbing. A lot of it's gonna be targeted towards Chattanooga, but again, it can be utilized anywhere in the world, some of the things that we're gonna talk about tonight. I am going to be the moderator as Sunshine with Outdoor Chattanooga. Robert's going to be our instructor, going to go through a presentation, and then we will have a very interactive Q&A at the end. Please note that we are utilizing a webinar format, and so all you need is to be able to see us. You won't have video, you won't have audio on your end, you'll just be able to watch us. And feel free to interact with us through the chat function or through the Q&A. If you guys don't know where the chat function is or the Q&A, if you'll take your cursor, if you're on a laptop or desktop, and kind of move it around over the screen, it should pop up a menu bar at the bottom to access both the chat and the Q&A. Click on those and you'll be able to type whatever you want. If you're on mobile, if you're watching us from your cell phone, same thing. Usually if you tap the screen, it'll wake it up, show the menu bar at the bottom. You might have to hit the three dots or a more in order to find the chat and other things, but fully functional on a mobile device as it is on a laptop or computer. So any questions or any technical issues, can't hear us, videos aren't playing well, please enter that in the chat. I will be monitoring that while Robert goes through the presentation. We are gonna talk all about rock climbing. And Robert, I'm going to let you take it away. Introduce yourself, tell us who you are, and let's get started.
Hello, everyone. My name is Robert Whitaker. I'm a senior at the University of Tennessee, and this spring I've been interning with Outdoor Chattanooga. I'm a pretty active rock climber. I was even outside today in Georgia rock climbing at Rocktown in Lafette. So I'm really excited to do this presentation, and I hope it's helpful for all of you to get a little introduction into rock climbing. Share my screen. All right. Ooh. All right. So this is going to be a beginner's guide to rock climbing. My testimony. So rock climbing has played a big role in my life in the last couple of years. It inspired me to get active. I've gone on amazing trips. This is just a few weeks ago. My friends and I went to Devil's Tower in Wyoming. And we actually climbed to the top of it. It's this route right here. I don't know if you can see my cursor. It helps you get out into nature. It's a physical activity, which keeps you healthy and pushed me in my comfort zone. So every single time I go climbing, I like to push myself a little further to see what I can do and to see what I can accomplish. And it also gives me a whole new appreciation for what nature has to offer. So when you do climb, you see new areas, new rock formations, you get into beautiful nature and wildlife areas, as well as when you get to the top of a route or a climb, you get a really good view as well, one that you normally wouldn't see from the trail that I find really beautiful and do my best to take pictures when I can. So I'm gonna show a couple of pictures from trips I've done around the Southeast. First one would be the Red River Gorge in Kentucky. This is in Slade, Kentucky. And a really famous area. It was a gorge filled out by a large river back in the day, and you can see the colors of the rock are really beautiful. This is Stone Depot, North Carolina. I did a multi-pitch here with a couple of my friends. As you can see in the top right corner of this left picture, that would be Looking Glass. It's a really well-known formation in North Carolina. So what is rock climbing? Rock climbing began as a part of alpinism as far as climbing mountains and has grown into a new sport as it's in its own right. There's three main climbing styles. So the first would be bouldering, which is shown above, sport climbing, which is to the right, and traditional climbing, which is on the bottom left. So bouldering is climbing boulders outside. It's also done in a gym, but it's when you climb boulders between 10 to 15 feet and you have your own protection, which are the pads you can see below them, and you don't have a rope or anything else, no harness, and it's just about climbing to the top. Sport climbing is when you're climbing a route that has bolts on it and you place quick draws as you go, and that's your protection. Traditional climbing is climbing a route that follows a feature that can be protected with traditional gear, which would be like climbing cams or nuts. I'll go over those in a few slides, but that's more placing your own protection. So these kind of come with their own varied levels of risk. So why would you rock climb? It's great exercise. There's a lot of adventure involved. You get to go out into wild remote areas and climb things that may have been climbed before or may not have been climbed before. Really push yourself and get out there. Problem solving. So rock climbing is really about, it's almost like solving a puzzle, especially when you're inside or in the gym. You have a certain amount of holds and a certain amount of ways you can go up it. And it you need a lot of creativity. Three people could climb the same route three different ways. And so I like the individuality of the sport as well as the community. So I met a lot of my best friends through the climbing gym, through meeting them outside of the crags. And it's a great way to meet people who are interested in the same thing as you, as well as interested in getting the outdoors. So the first sport part I'm going to go over is bouldering. So this is outside bouldering. This picture is from Rocktown in Lafayette, Georgia. So it's climbing shorter routes with no ropes. You usually have a spotter or a crash pad, someone to guide you onto the crash pads if you do fall. They're shorter problems where you're trying to climb as hard as possible. So pushing yourself as far as pulling small moves or shorter, like pulling a small amount of moves and getting to the top. The grading system uses the V-scale, and I will go over the grading system for both sport climbing and bouldering in a couple slides. This is a really popular way of climbing just because it relies on the least amount of gear. All you need is shoes, chalk, and a crash pad, and you can climb pretty much any boulder that you want to walk up to if the holds are there for you to be able to do it.
Hey, Robert, I forgot to do our poll to find out if where everyone's at, if anyone's ever climbed before. Do you mind if we do that real quick?
Sure.
Let's see how many people are actually paying attention and awake. So I'm gonna ask you guys a question. It should pop up on your screen. Submit an answer. Let us know. Have you climbed before? Robert, what's your guess? Most people on the call, do you think they've climbed before or not?
I think it's gym climbing has become pretty popular for birthday parties and summer camps take you outside. So I feel like a couple people have some experience doing it before.
We got 78% voted, 82% voted, and I will share the results. Most people on the call haven't, barely, 10 out of 9.
Cool.
So, yeah, for those of you that have climbed, here's a follow-up question. Where have you climbed? Or for those of you that haven't, maybe you've climbed in your dreams. I really liked adding that as an option. So this is also to make sure you guys are paying attention to Robert's very engaging presentation tonight. So where have you guys climbed before if you have climbed? I think that everyone has had an opportunity to vote. I'm gonna close this out and hopefully you all can see the answers. Most people have been outside on real rock. That's impressive because a lot, like you said, Robert, most people start in the gym. All right, we have a couple more we can launch later on, but thank you for allowing me to do that. I didn't want those to go to waste, so.
All right, so I guess a lot of you have gone outside, but sport climbing is probably the easiest way to get into climbing outside besides top roping. You go to a developed crag that people have gone to before, and they've either rappelled in or climbed up and put in bolts along the way. As you can see, he's got a quick draw right there, which is two carabiners attached to each other by a piece of material, and he clips that in as he follows the route up and protects himself each level every time he gets through a new bolt. This is the grade scale, is the Yosemite Decimal Scale in the United States. I'll go over that now. Or not. Okay, there we go. So for beginner climbing, you're gonna, so the bouldering scale is the V scale, and the sport climbing scale is the Yosemite Decimal Scale. They don't quite parallel, but this is just a rough estimate of what I would consider the levels. So beginner climbing could be anywhere from VB or V0 to about V2, V1, V2. And beginner outside on sport climbing would be about, it goes all the way down to 5.6 or 5.5, but anywhere between 5.5 to 5.8, 5.9, 5.10, low 5.10. Intermediate is around V2 to V5. And that would be 5.10 to 5.12 minus outside. Advanced is V5 to V9, which is 5.12 plus to 5.14. Professionals V10 plus and 5.14. And just for reference, the hardest boulder in the world is V17, and the hardest route in the world is 5.15D. So it gets a little crazy when you get to the top end of the difficulty. You can even, I've looked at problems and can't even imagine how people would possibly hold themselves up, much less climb the entire thing. So this is really just necessary to show you how when you go into a gym or you do go outside, you know the level that you should kind of be working at instead of getting frustrated or in over your head on something a little harder. So top rope climbing, this is usually the first way that people climb outside. So it's when the rope is going through two clips at the top and it's feeding down. So when you're sport climbing, if you fall, you can fall downward. You'll fall back to where your last draw was. But when you're top rope climbing, you just swing off. So this is the safest way for people to climb outside because it's the lowest risk of any kind of fall and hitting the ground. This is usually the way that a guide will take you outside. So if you're going outside with a guide or with a summer camp, they usually take people top rope climbing. It's the safest way to go about it. And there's a lot of places that, especially in Chattanooga, but you will find routes that are available. So you can hike to the top of the cliff and you'll be able to reach the anchors from the top, reach over, clip the rope in, and lower down and climb from the top, from the bottom to the top. Trad climbing, this is probably the most advanced version of climbing I'll talk about. It's the original way that people began climbing. Instead of having bolts on walls, you place your own gear. So in this picture, you can see, you can barely see it, but he's holding, it's a cam device. So what it does is essentially gets smaller, gets bigger. It umbrellas when you put it into a crack, and it acts as your protection to keep the rope in place if you fall. This is utilized best for big wall climbing. So if you've ever seen Free Solo, Alex Honnold of Trad climbed a lot of those routes before he got up there. There's not usually bolts on the bigger walls. And you can use this for multi-pitch as well. This is a very much an adventure style of climbing. With trad climbing equipment, if you're at a certain level, you can approach any rock in the world that you wanted to and walk up and climb it as long as the protection was there. So the best place I would recommend to begin is the gym. This is because it's a safe environment. You would begin probably bouldering or sport climbing, but they have auto belays that have ropes that would carry you up and catch you if you fall by yourself. It's a really safe environment. There's pads all over the place. There's trained instructors there to give you instructions when you get there on safety, the safety of climbing, how to fall properly, give you the whole run of everything you'd need to know. It also provides the equipment so you don't have to make a big initial investment if you are going to get into climbing. So instead of having to buy shoes and then decide whether or not you want to climb or not, you can go there, rent shoes. They'll also teach you to belay, which is the way that you protect someone while climbing. So it's the other person holding the rope, and there's certain devices that go along with that. In Chattanooga, we have two main gyms. That would be Synergy and High Point. High Point has two locations in town. Both of these gyms have their own climbing guides. They can take you outside. They have really good coaches and instructors. So if you do want individual instruction as far as like performance or learning how to get the basics down, they have coaches that you can hire. There's also climbing leagues. So if you have a kid or you're in middle school or high school, you can check your local gyms. But in Chattanooga, they have a competition league. And really, this is just a way to get kids involved in climbing through the school. So it's not necessarily about pushing the difficulty, but it creates a group environment for people to learn and to be encouraged. The one in Chattanooga was developed by Outdoor Chattanooga, and now there's up to 12 local schools involved. So if you live in an area where there is a lot of climbing, it's probably a good chance that they have a climbing league through the high school, whether it be a club or a team. And it's just a really good way to meet other people who are also climbing. So what is belaying? So it is a device. Belaying is using a device to control the rope. So when you're top roping, it's the other person on the end. So at the bottom here, we have two different devices. We have the ATC, which has been used to belay people for probably close to 30 to 40 years. And then the Gri-Gri that came out maybe 15 years ago. So these protect people from falling. It's what catches the rope. Instead of having somebody just down there holding the rope with their hands, this device actively helps them control the rope and make sure that you don't fall. So the Gri-Gri auto locks. It has a device in it that when the rope feels pressure from the top, it pinches it and stops it. The ATC relies more on operator applying pressure to the rope. And so it's just a little less safe. A lot of people have began switching to Gri-Gris just because it does have that insurance and that fail safe. You can check with your gym to see what age you can learn to belay, but they also have regular belay classes. Outdoor Chattanooga does their own belay classes. We have one specifically for this group that I believe is May 15th or 16th, that you guys who signed up for this class will have specific access to. It'll be at the Walnut Wall in Chattanooga, right outside of the Outdoor Chattanooga building, or we'll teach you the basics of how to belay so that you can go out yourself or go to the gym and be able to actively climb routes.
And just to piggyback on that, Robert, we are offering an open climb day at the Walnut Wall on May 16th, I believe it's a Sunday. I'm going to drop a link in the chat for you guys that want to come and do that. There are 30-minute sessions that you can sign up for. We provide all the equipment, we provide instruction, and you get 30 minutes to wear yourself out and try to climb to the top of a 50-foot limestone pier and get an awesome view of the Tennessee River. So I will drop that in the chat.
Great. I hope to see a lot of you there. Our next slide is climbing jargon. So around the gym or around the crag, you're going to hear a lot of these words. So it's nice to know what they're talking about when you go in. So the first would be beta. Beta is information on a route as far as you'd say, what's the beta to climbing this route? And they would talk you through the moves that are there and then like the specific ways to go about it. It's a good way to ask for help. And that's just the term that people use. Sandbag. This is usually outside, you hear this kind of word, but sandbag is when a route is harder than advertised. So if say you're a 5A climber, but someone's like, oh, that's a 5A, but it's sandbag, you should be a little cautious because it may be harder than you're used to. Ascend is accomplishing a route. So whether you're bouldering, that's getting to the top without falling. And if you're sport climbing, it's getting all the way to the top without falling as well. Sometimes you can fall and hang and then go back up, and that's not technically ascend, but that's what the word means if you're interested in completing routes and kind of like that's how climbing qualifies you as finishing a route. Pumped is when you're really tired. So a common theme in climbing is you're using your forearms and your shoulders and your back a lot. So when you're really pumped, your forearms will feel like really hard. The muscles will be really, really tired. And so that the term for that is pumped. And then crag is a collection of outdoor climbing areas. So the crag would be either where all the boulders are or the cliff line where all the routes are. So you can find, that's just the term for the areas you're climbing. Let's see. Jeez. Okay, so equipment. So to start, if you're going to be getting to climbing, you've gone to the gym, you tried on shoes there, and you decide, okay, I'm going to get into climbing, I want to buy my own shoes, I'm tired of renting them. You're going to want shoes, a chalk bag and chalk, and a harness. So having your own equipment makes it a little bit easier to go outside, as well as save you the small amount of money at the gym. So the gym will charge you for shoes and a harness and a chalk bag every time you go. But if you buy your own, it makes it a little bit easier for you. So why do you need these specific things? So climbing shoes, as you can see at the bottom left here, are covered in rubber on the bottom. So the rubber gives you better traction, as well as there's a couple key elements to the shoe. The toe, so if you can see, the toe kind of comes to a point right here, right where your big toe would be. And that helps you apply all the pressure from your legs onto a specific small area. So this helps with climbing because you're not always going to have a large area to step on. You're going to need some precision, as well as the rubber is meant for friction. So it's meant to stick onto the holds. It's meant to help you. It's a tool. Climbing shoes are a tool to help you climb better. Chalk is a drying agent. So when you're climbing, your hands get really sweaty sometimes. And when they're sweaty, it's harder to hold onto the holds. It's harder to hold onto the rock. So you keep chalk to kind of like dry your hands and make sure they're dry to get the best friction as possible. Having your own harness is going to be a little bit more comfortable, just because the harnesses that you buy at REI or any kind of outdoor store are usually going to provide a little bit more support and are going to be a little bit more comfortable than the ones you would rent. And when you're hanging up on a route for up to 30 minutes at a time, you're going to really want some comfortability, just because it can really, like, your legs can fall asleep and they can just be uncomfortable and it can lead you to have less fun of a time. So bouldering, the first steps of bouldering, like the first equipment you're going to need would be a crash pad. So these are two crash pads right here. They vary in size and design. So most of them are square. It's usually about 4 to 5 inches of like some high density foam. So you can place them over rocks. They not only protect you from falling to where it cushions for your feet and your knees, but also you can place pads over specifically like sharp rocks, or if it's an uneven landing, you don't want to fall and twist your ankle. They're pretty good. They work really well. When you do fall, I've fallen from pretty high, maybe like 15 feet or 20 feet or so. And they do save your knees a lot, and they save your feet and can really prevent you from having injuries. So sport climbing, you need a rope, quick draws, and a blade device. So climbing rope is a specific kind of rope. It has multiple, I think I have a slide about climbing rope as well, but it has like, it's a specific rope that's dynamic that stretches so that when you do fall and weight it, it doesn't have a lot of built up tension. It makes it for a softer fall. Quick draws are what you place in the clips as you go up. If you're sport climbing, but that's a little bit longer down the road. And then a belay device you can get to use in the gym to save money as well, because they'll often require you to pay to rent one. So for something in between the gym and going all the way outside, we do have the Walnut Wall in Chattanooga. So the clinic is May 16th from 2 to 5 p.m. for people who attend this workshop. It is free, but you do have to register before. We can provide all the gear, and in this case, you don't necessarily need climbing shoes if you're just trying it for the first time. But the Walnut Wall does have holds. You're not just climbing these square blocks. If you can look carefully, there's these specific climbing holds bolted onto the wall. And it's a really fun activity to do. It's right in the center of Coolidge Park. You get a really good view of the park as well as the river. And you get a lot of people to come up to you at the fence and say, wow, this is really crazy. Can I do this? And it's a really good time and fun to get outside.
Yeah, and just so you guys know, I did drop that link if you do want to register. If you live locally and you're available on May 16th, anytime between 2 and 5, come out and join us. Robert's going to be working. I might be working. We will be there to help give you maybe your first experience ever rock climbing. We would love to have that opportunity. But the link is in the chat if you guys are interested in registering for that.
Okay, so you've climbed in the gym. You've come to our Climb Outside Outdoor Chattanooga event, and you're ready to go outside on your own. So for the first time, you're going to want to find a guide, either a guide or someone that you trust and know has real experience outside and has your best interest and safety in mind. So a guide, you can hire them through High Point Synergy. They both have their own guides, so you can call them up, go on their website, And if you're outside of Chattanooga, if you just look up your area and look up climbing guides, there should be people around that can help you, as whether it's through a climbing gym or a guiding company on their own. In Tennessee and the Chattanooga area, we do have Climb with the Ranger days. So the Obed Scenic River area outside of Knoxville has Climb with the Ranger days, and Hiawassee Ocoee State Parks also do. So these are just days where you can go out for free with rangers who are part like park rangers of that park, and they'll take you to the location and take you climbing. They'll provide all the equipment, safety equipment, helmets, and just facilitate the experience for you so you can try for the first time. Outdoor Chattanooga also has a resource page with guide information for local Chattanooga guides.
Yes, and I just dropped that in the chat as well. So if you guys want to link out to our rock climbing page, it will be that local resource for all things rock climbing in the greater Chattanooga region.
So how safe is climbing? The strength of gear. So how durable is a rope? As you can see here, this rope has multiple parts to it. There's the outer sheath that works to protect the inner strands. So the rope is meant to stretch a little bit, because if it didn't stretch and you fell, it would provide a really rough catch, is what we call, which means it would jerk you and sling you into the rock, which could result in an injury. But when it's dynamic and it stretches, it makes it for a little bit of a softer swing into the rock, and you can catch yourself with your feet. So you want to be able to check a rope or make sure the rope is relatively new, because over time they do wear. I believe that REI, and I'm sure other outdoor places, will check your rope for free for you if you take it in. So if you do have an old rope sitting in your garage because your dad used to climb, or your mom used to climb, or your cousin climbed and he gave it to you, make sure you take it in somewhere and have it checked, just so that it's safe and you don't go out there with a damaged rope. You want to use belay devices, preferably the safest one you can find. There's some old school ones that I'm sure people have laying around, but you'd want to use an ATC or a Grigory, preferably one that you've been trained in the gym to use. There's also climbing knots. So you want to make sure you have the figure eight knot down, which is the knot you use to tie into the rope to the harness. Most serious accidents are human error, not necessarily equipment error when climbing. So it's not often that you have rope problems. It's more of your belayer not paying attention to dropping you. So make sure you have a trusted belayer and that you're communicating well, especially when climbing outside. And the last is to wear a helmet. So climbing, there are specific climbing helmets, but most helmets will work. And I've got a little video to show you a funny, lucky accident. That's why you wear a helmet. This happened at the T-Wall in Chattanooga.
And that's why we wear a helmet. Did you see that?
No.
I would have been tripped to the ER, Gavin. Can you believe that? Oh my gosh. That would have been a trip to the ER had I not been wearing a helmet. Oh my gosh. Gavin, that landed right on my head. Woo!
So as you can see, in this case, he was fortunate to be wearing a helmet while belaying, and it saved him a trip to the ER. Rocks fall off the wall, gear falls off the person climbing, anything can happen, and you want to have that helmet on to protect yourself at all times. And people wear them while climbing as well, obviously, because sometimes you can fall and be swung weird into the rock, and it's just always wear a helmet. Why not be safe when you can? Most accidents are avoidable, and head injuries are serious, and you should wear a helmet because climbing can be dangerous. So outdoor ethics, this is kind of based on where you're at. So every different crag and every different area of climbing in the country, in the world, they have their own ethics. They have a certain way that climbing area was developed with certain climbing ideas in mind. So whether or not that be like areas where you don't want to bolt any routes, where there's no bolts, it's only trad climbing. There are areas specifically in the Southwest where there's like orange rock, like orange sandstone, where they don't allow you to use white chalk. You have to use either these eco balls or chalk color the same as the rock, just because it can be visibly just like it can make the rock look ugly if there's a bunch of white marks all over this orange rock in an area where people go to look at the rocks. It can just be problematic, as well as it's just a respect of the area. So if you are going somewhere new, you always want to respect the culture that's there. And it's important to know what the culture is in order to respect it, so you don't just come in and make a huge disruption or disturb and potentially ruin an area. So where to find them for Tennessee? We have the East Tennessee Climbing Coalition as well as the Southeastern Climbing Coalition. So East Tennessee is more specific to Chattanooga, Knoxville, that kind of area and in between. And the Southeastern Climbing Coalition is for all of the Southeast. There are climbing coalitions all across the country and all across the world where you can go to their website. They'll not only tell you about the areas that you can climb there and how to access them, but also tell you the rules and regulations specific to each of those. One of the main things we focus on that's kind of across the board is Leave No Trace, which I have a video for coming up next.
As climbers, we have an ethical responsibility to work together to take care of our shared resources, namely the places where we love to climb. And this could mean a city park or a national park wilderness area like Joshua Tree. These public spaces are not solely our responsibility, but as one of the main user groups of a place like Joshua Tree, we do have a lot of responsibility to take care of the place. And also, in order to maintain access to this place, we need to be good stewards of the place. Climbing in a national park isn't a right, it is a privilege. The Park Service could forbid climbing, placing bolts or replacing old bolts. Because I love this place, and also because I love climbing, I have a real need to be a good steward of this place. There is an existing framework. The Leave No Trace organization has put a lot of research into guidelines that we should try to follow in different types of environment. You can think about deserts and canyons and mountains and other environments as having different sets of guidelines that we should try to follow.
Okay, so he goes on to talk about Leave No Trace ethics in Joshua Tree, but generally speaking, the rules are that you take in what you you bring out. So if you brought snacks, if you bought wrappers, plastic bottles, you want to take all that out with you. You also want to stay on the trails as much as possible. You don't want to walk over the vegetation and disturb anything. And climbing, you often see raptor closures, which means that there are birds nesting in routes and you don't want to climb them because you'll agitate their nest. And we're really... climbing is all about enjoying the outdoor, but also not disrupting what's already there. So if we can keep nature as wild as it is while also having our chance at experiencing it, that's the most important thing. You don't want to ruin an area's entire ecological system or scare all the animals off just because we're there to climb. It was their home first, and we're just visiting on a day-to-day basis.
As climbers, we have an...
So climbing right now, climbing is bigger than it's ever been. People are climbing harder than they've ever before. So first question, would you consider climbing an Olympic sport? Can we run that poll, Sunshine? Do we have that one set up?
We do.
So the question is, how many of you consider rock climbing an Olympic sport? I kind of give away the answer in the slide, but
all right, we got a little over half have voted. This is also a way to see if they're paying attention, right, Robert? Since you kind of gave the answer away.
Pop quiz.
Yeah, pop quiz. Making sure you guys are paying attention. Nancy, thanks for joining us. We'll follow up with everyone with an email if you do need to bounce out. Thanks for joining us so far. All right, I'm going to end this poll and share the results. Here are the answers, Robert.
So a majority of you knew the correct answer. The answer is yes, climbing is an Olympic sport. It'll be the first time it's featured. We'll be in the Tokyo Olympics this summer. There's been a lot of controversy surrounding the sport, mainly the way it's going to be graded. So there's sport climbing, which is This is a picture of Brooke Rabatoo. She was actually the first American person to qualify for the Olympics. There are two women and two men. The other one is Kyra Condie. The other female is Kyra Condie, and the two men are Colin Duffy and Nathaniel Coleman. So there are three styles of climbing in the competition. There's sport climbing, bouldering, and speed. The controversy came regarding speed climbing because a main component of climbing is really just the difficulty of the route. In the past, all the competitions have been surrounded around who can climb the furthest on the route or who can do the route in the least amount of tries. And adding speed climbing is just a completely different sport. It's the same route every single time. It's all about getting it to the top as fast as possible. So some of the traditional climbers who are good at climbing hard problems aren't necessarily fast. So there's been a little bit of controversy around whether or not it should be included. I believe that going forward, they're going to be split up. Sport and bouldering will probably still stay together, but speed climbing will become a completely entire different event as its own. So this next video is, see if it loads, Sasha Julian. She's a Canadian climber, and it has her talking about climbing in the Tokyo 2020 or 2021 Olympics.
I think that climbing being included in the Olympic Games for 2020 brings incredible opportunity for the athletes and climbing enthusiasts worldwide to be a part of the largest world stage. The IOC recognizing climbing as a sport is an incredible opportunity for climbers involved in the industry, professional athletes, as well as people who just take climbing as a hobby, to be exposed to more of an audience. The explosion of climbing as a sport in the last 5 years can be paralleled with the interest in outdoor sports in general and this idea of outdoor adventures, because at its roots, climbing is a very outdoor driven sport. Climbing is a very mental and physical sport. It requires you to think your way through solving sequences. And while climbing, it's basically like you have a jigsaw puzzle that you need to solve. And you need to solve that puzzle both mentally and physically. There are three different disciplines to the sport. There's speed climbing, which is essentially a head-to-head race where the fastest climber wins. There's sport climbing, which is judged on difficulty. So the person who gets highest up a wall with a rope wins. And then there's bouldering. Which is shorter walls and no rope. But if you fall, you fall on essentially a gymnastic pad. And the winner of that, who does the best on a composite of different boulder problems, is the winner. For the Olympics, it will be the best overall climber across all three disciplines. Climbing being involved in the Olympics is a huge accomplishment for the sport overall. I'm really excited by the opportunity to be a part of the Olympics in 2020. Yeah.
Cool. So actually that video shows a lot of cool highlights of indoor climbing as well as a little footage of outside. Most of the climbing you'll run across in the gym is not quite as dynamic as what they were doing. They were doing a lot of jumping, a lot of leaping and multiple jumping movements. It really doesn't start that aggressive. That's really higher level stuff. And especially the gym style is a little different than the outdoor style. You wouldn't see a lot of that movement outside as you would inside. Do we have any questions?
Linda wants to know, how likely is it to see a snake around the rocks? Because she would have a straight up heart attack.
So
how many snakes have you encountered while climbing, Robert?
I've encountered 3 snakes while climbing. They were all at the same location. Luckily, they were pretty out in the open, but we were walking around a boulder field, and it was kind of a more remote boulder field. It wasn't one as traveled as often, and they were sunbathing right below the rocks. So, and occasionally you will see snakes. This was in North Georgia at Zond. So they were copperheads. We identified them as copperheads, but you run into them sometimes, but that's the only time that I've seen them. Most of the time the areas are pretty well traveled. So I think that the snakes would avoid those areas. Those are the only ones I've seen. I've seen one small snake at the Obed, but it was more of like a garter snake, and it was more afraid of us than we were afraid of it. So generally speaking, you see more birds, maybe deer, that kind of stuff. And lizards, a lot of lizards.
Yeah, no one's laughing at you, Linda. It is a common fear and a common question that is asked about snakes. So anytime you're in a natural environment, you are going to can encounter things that occur in that natural environment. So snakes are out there in the world. They don't like humans. They try to avoid humans. But if you are kind of going to a remote place that isn't frequented by humans, it is a little more likely that you might actually see one. So just something to be mindful of when you're climbing, but like Robert said, more likely to encounter a big old bird or a little lizard or something else while out there. If anybody has any questions, feel free to drop them in the Q&A. Any questions at all would be great. Terry says there is a great route at T-Wall called Where Lizards Go to Die. Have you done that one, Robert?
I have not done that one yet, but that is where I've seen a lot of lizards, is at T-Wall. So Nancy asked how much adult harnesses are typically. The lower level ones start around $50 to $60 probably if you don't find them on sale. And they can get really expensive after that. I'm sure you could probably pay upwards of $200 for a harness, but the beginner harnesses are $50 to $60.
Yeah, good. We did get a question coming into the Q&A. Terry would like to know what knots are best to know for a beginner climber.
So the main knot you really need to know is the figure eight knot. It's something that you would learn your very first time in the climbing gym if you're taking a belay class. It is the knot that attaches your harness to the rope. Other useful knots would be like a clove hitch, which you can use. That's more for multi-pitch climbing and that kind of thing. It's something that you would use to attach yourself to an anchor. It's basically making a knot in the rope that attaches you to a specific spot and won't let you move. I would say that and like maybe an overhand knot. So if you're belaying and the person is taking a rest and they're hanging there and you're waiting the rope, you can tie an overhand knot right above where the rope is feeding into the belay device in the slack end, and it'll prevent, you can go hands-free, get a drink of water, whatever, and it will prevent the rope from sliding through because the knot will get jammed in the system. So you can go hands-free.
Awesome. Sean would like to know, what age typically can kids begin safely climbing?
I've seen very young kids climbing. I've seen kids around 5 or 6 years old. I know that a lot of gyms don't let kids climb or don't let kids boulder under the age of 13. That's just because of the height of the walls inside and the distance of the fall when they're that small. But I've seen kids, plenty of kids that are 5 and 6 years old beginning climbing. They definitely have classes and coaches and teams for kids that age. It's actually helpful to start them younger if you do think they're going to be interested in climbing, strictly because as they're growing and the earlier on they start using their fingers for finger strength and the ligaments in their fingers, they become more durable over long term. So I started rock climbing. Well, I rock climbed for the first time when I was really young, but I didn't start taking it seriously until maybe 3 years ago. And I've had to deal with some lingering finger issues because of that.
Yeah, thanks, Robert. So how can a beginner climber get started with physical fitness to help with climbing? Are there certain exercises or activities they can do to make them a better climber?
So the first one I'd probably do is pull-ups. So pull-ups are obviously a big part of climbing, especially early on when you're not quite used to utilizing your legs as much as you can. But pull-ups are really, like, if you could start doing a lot of pull-ups, that's going to give you a lot more endurance and be able to extend your training. Once you get a little bit further, you can get into, like, developing your finger strength with fingerboarding. But you really want to follow. If you do get into the fingerboarding, you're interested in that, I would definitely look up a training regimen, just because if you do that kind of recklessly, you can result in finger injuries. You also use your core a lot. So any kind of ab workout, any kind of your typical ab workout to keep your core in shape, and flexibility. A lot of gyms offer yoga. I know that High Point Synergy both offer yoga for free with a membership, and any kind of flexibility will become really helpful. And then also just general fitness, any kind of workout that works out your upper body and your shoulders, it's all going to help you in the long run.
Yeah, I would agree with that. Good answer, Robert. Buck brings up a good point. Buying used gear, as much as we all want to save a buck and maybe buy something that's been used, rock climbing gear is kind of one of those things that you don't necessarily want to do. You don't want to jump into used ropes or used harnesses. And can you kind of explain why, Robert?
So with used gear, you really don't know how much it's been through, how bad it's been treated. So especially with ropes, you just don't know how many falls have been on it. Each rope is kind of graded on a scale of how many falls it can take, its durability. And when you buy a used rope, you really have no idea of what the trauma that rope has been through. And so therefore you can't really accurately assess how much you want to do on that rope, how much you can trust it. Harnesses are the same way. Harnesses can wear through, the belay loops can wear through. Helmets, I don't see too many used helmets for sale, but it's a similar thing. You just don't know what wear and tear they've been through. Used climbing shoes are you see those a little more often. I bought used shoes in the past, but you do have to keep an eye out for what kind of shape they're in, if they're beat up. But most of the time it's best to buy your own gear unless it's from a very, very well-trusted source, just because you're relying so much on it. You're really, like, your life is on the line if your rope breaks. So you want to buy a rope that you know and you can be confident in.
Yeah, definitely. We have a question about, are school scholarships available for climbers? And I'm assuming that's at the collegiate level. Do you know if colleges, Robert, have rock climbing teams and offer scholarships for students to attend that school and be on the rock climbing team?
So I'm not positive about scholarships. I do know that there are a lot of climbing teams and climbing clubs. I think out west, you may see, there may be scholarships that come from, like, it's like a climbing, I'm not sure. I'm honestly not sure about, like, it's not like a typical college scholarship where your performance can get you a spot at the school through it. But I think that there are probably, if you join a climbing team at a school, there might be scholarships that become available to you for being active in the climbing community. I know that out west, it's really big. A lot of, like, schools like Stanford and Colorado, they have college-wide competitions, and those schools out west, especially in the Rocky Mountain area, have a lot of funding for their teams.
Yeah, awesome. I just real quick before we get into any more questions, I really want to thank you guys for taking an hour out of your day to spend it with us and learn about rock climbing. Hopefully you found this valuable. I did drop a survey link into the chat. If you guys don't mind taking a second to fill that out, let us know how we're doing, how Robert did, what other outdoor topics you would like to learn about. If you're not familiar with Outdoor Chattanooga, go find us online at outdoorchattanooga.com. Follow us on social media, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and drop us a line. We have a newsletter that we send out once a month that highlights all the activities going on around Chattanooga, as well as what we're offering. So that's kind of the shameless plug for Outdoor Chattanooga and everything we're offering. To get back to the questions, Robert, what are some beginner-friendly routes near Chattanooga?
So the best resource I would give you would be Mountain Project. It doesn't have everything, but it can show you the easier routes in Chattanooga. based on grade. I know that Foster Falls has a lot of easier difficulty routes in the 5.6, 5.7 range. I guess the main problem you would run into is whether or not you could lead climb them. I know the Sunset Wall has a lot of options for easier climbing, as well as cliff top access where you could set up a top rope yourself. But Mountain Project would be the first place I would go, unless you're interested in buying a guidebook for the local area.
Well, and that is all the questions I see so far. I realize that I need to correct and make it an option for people to select the rock climbing workshop as which workshop did you attend in the survey. So I will go over and fix that real quick. That looks like all the questions we have. I'll give it another second or two to see if anybody has anything else they'd like to ask tonight.
Yeah, thank you all for coming. Rock climbing is something I'm really passionate about. So to be able to help anybody either get into it or learn more about it is amazing for me. I love spreading the sport. If you have any questions about gear or anything like that, I could go grab some stuff and go over it. If you're really interested, I can talk about this all night. So as long as you keep having questions, I can keep talking.
Yeah. Robert, if you want to take a minute, we have a few minutes left till the 8 o'clock hour. We'll get everyone what they paid for the full hour. So if you want to like grab any of the gear, Buck asked if you want to talk about the climbing harness versus the mountaineering harness. I don't even know that. Do you know the difference between those two,
Robert? I'm not positive on the specific difference. My guess would be that climbing harnesses may be built more for comfort. And they're a little bit more durable, meant for hanging, while mountaineering harnesses would probably be as light as possible, just because when you are doing mountaineering expeditions, they're really trying to shave down weight where they can. But at the same time, it could be the opposite, where a mountaineering harness would be one more built for like weather conditions, as far as more durable for cold conditions or more comfortable to sit in all day. Because when you do a mountaineering expedition or a multi-pitch, you do a lot of hanging around, a lot of weighting your harness. So it might be something more about comfortability than weight.
Yeah, cool. Any gear you want to show off, Robert? Any cool things? And then stop sharing your screen so you become a little bigger, but any cool gear you want to show off tonight?
Sure. I can run and grab some stuff real quick.
Okay. So bouldering versus route climbing. As soon as Robert comes back, we'll ask that question on which of those is the best to start with. Yeah, guys, I apologize. I totally did not add the rock climbing as an option for which workshop did you attend. So hiking 101, if that's what you want to put in, that would be fine. It's going to timestamp it, so I'll be able to tell the difference. I so apologize for that. Like I said, we did our first six and they did so well. We started offering these once a month thereafter, and I failed to update the survey with these new workshop offerings. So again, like I said before, we're awesome at playing outside and teaching others how to do it. Technology is secondary to that. So I appreciate your guys' patience there. So yeah, pick hiking 101, that will be sufficient, and I'll be able to tell the difference. Robert went away, like just disappeared to go find his gear. I think he had to go to the closet to do it, or maybe out to the shed. I personally think that bouldering might be a little easier because it requires less gear, but route climbing and a gym is a little more common, and it definitely gets you experience with the harness and the knot tying and dealing with the belay devices. So if you guys need to log off, you are welcome to. Robert's going to show off some of his gear that he uses to climb with. If you're interested in that, please stick around. Take a moment to fill out the survey. Pick hiking 101 instead of rock climbing 101, since I did not update that. And if you have any questions, we will send a follow-up email after the workshop ends. It'll include the slideshow presentation if you would like that. the recording link, the link to the survey. And then that way you have contact information for us. So if you ever want to follow up and ask anything of Robert or Outdoor Chattanooga staff, you'll be able to do so. And I do want to remind you guys of an opportunity to try rock climbing for free. If you've never done it and you're curious about it, the rock climbing at the Walnut Wall that we're offering is a great way to get introduced to the sport. We provide all the equipment minus climbing shoes, but a harness. We have belayers. We'll teach you some basic things and allow you to climb up the wall. It's just a good way to give it a try without investing any money or anything at all. That way, if you like it, maybe you can find other ways to get plugged in. For those of you that don't live locally, I'm sorry, unless you want to come all the way down from Las Vegas or Canada, we would love to see you, but I know that will make that difficult. So, all right, Robert, I'm going to stop chit-chatting. Well, while you're getting your gear together, somebody would like to know, do you like bouldering or route climbing, and which is better to start with? What personally do you like bouldering or route climbing, and then which one do you think is a better form of climbing to start with?
So personally, tends to fluctuate. There's kind of people, there are seasons for climbing. So some people consider the winter, like the colder months, bouldering season, because when it's colder, you have better friction and you can, it's easier to pull harder moves. And then people consider the summer, the sport season. I would recommend to start, probably bouldering is the easiest way to get into it. It's cheaper than buying all the gear for as far as a rope, quick draws, all that kind of stuff. There's a little bit less risk and you have a little bit more control over your risk as far as not climbing anything outside of your comfort zone and it being shorter. A crash pad is maybe 150 to start, 180 bucks. And you can go to those places. And that's also what the gyms usually kind of cater around. There are sport climbing routes at the gyms, but most of the gyms are built around bouldering.
All right. No more questions come through. So go ahead and show off your gear while we close this out.
Okay. So this is my harness. It's got leg loops, belay loop. This one's got a lot of padding in the legs. So they're really wide so that they aren't necessarily like pinching a specific spot on your leg. They've got loops on the side for your gear. This is a Grigri. And you always want to have a locking carabiner on your belay device. This is so that the carabiner doesn't become unlocked and open up. So this device has this, the camming device. And what happens is the rope will run through here. And when it's pulled, this device will cam down right here. The rope will get pinched like this. And it will automatically hold it for you versus an ATC. Where it's got, mine has grooves on it. Not all of them have grooves, but the rope runs through here and it's more relied on you pulling the rope and applying the pressure for it to catch versus the device itself catching you. So that's why Grigris are considered a little more safer at the moment, just because they will automatically with pressure just pinch on the rope. Let's see, you also have, some other things I have is like a direct. This is a specific piece of, it's called a direct because when you climb certain routes or specifically sport climb, you get to the anchors. You need a piece of rope to connect yourself to the anchors when you're done in order to set up an anchor. Anchor building is a whole different, I could give a whole nother presentation on that, so I won't today. There's oftentimes, especially track climbing routes, you need to rappel. So you usually rappel with an ATC and a prusik. This is a prusik that's kind of flatter, but this basically is, it holds onto the rope. It's another piece you can attach to the rope that makes rappelling softer and smoother, as well as catching on the rope if you begin to slide too much. I've got a quick draw right here. So for sport climbing, this is what I was talking about earlier. There's a rope side and there's a bolt side. And then I put a little piece of tape on here to identify my own gear. But this is what you would climb up and clip this in and then clip the rope into this as you go up. That's for sport climbing. And then track climbing, I don't have any nuts with me at the moment, but this is what a cam is. So you would find a crack and you would place it in like this, and you'd want it to kind of jam and catch in a specific position. Track climbing is something you really need someone to teach you to do, someone who knows what they're doing because of the level of risk. But this is the kind of device people use to protect themselves while track climbing. I also have my helmet. I put a bunch of stickers on it. You don't have to put stickers on it. It's usually the main part of the helmets you want to protect are your forehead and your back of your head. It's a pretty common thing in sport climbing to backstep, which is when the rope gets caught behind your foot. And when you fall, you get thrown backwards and you usually hit your back on the wall or hit your head. So that's the main reason I wear a helmet, is to prevent from hitting myself in the back of the head on the rock if I do backstep. Because sometimes there are just situations where the rope gets tangled up in your feet and it's better to be safe than sorry. This is a chalk pot. So this is not one that you would have on the back of your harness. This is meant for bouldering. It holds a bunch of chalk. It's got a pocket on it. And then brushes. So it's very common to brush holds, whether you're bouldering or in a gym. You want to brush off all the excess chalk so that you get more of that natural friction. One really important thing that has actually come up in the community quite recently is using the proper brush. So there are vegan brushes that don't use, but these are hog. It's like hog hair. And so they're really stiff. And what you don't want to use is plastic brushes. So plastic brushes, when you're brushing, the heat from the friction can sometimes melt the pieces of the plastic, and then the hold gets plastic on it. Like outside, the natural rock gets plastic on it and it makes it slicker and harder to hold. So if you are using a brush, you want to make sure that you're using a proper brush, either a boar's hair brush or a vegan alternative. They sell all brushes in all different shapes and sizes, but it's important to know the right one so you don't do any permanent damage to the rocks. I think that's all I brought with me. I can go over, this is an auto-locking carabiner. You have to twist it, but when you close it, it automatically turns so that you can't open it anymore. This is just a simple locking carabiner where it'll open and then you have to screw it tight to where it won't lock anymore. I think that's all the gear I have. Does anybody else have any questions?
And know that if you boulder, you don't need half of that stuff. You don't need any of that stuff. You just need a crash pad and the shoes and the bag of chalk.
I did bring a shoe. To show, this is a moccasin style. So there are laces, Velcro, moccasin style. These are pretty worn down, as you can see. Maybe you can't see. The toe is pretty worn down. It started to fade, kind of go underneath. So the toe is really where it wears. And then you have like a protected heel, but the shoe is usually like a sticky rubber. And then the whole sizing of a shoe is a whole different thing. You want to size them pretty snug, but you don't want them to be too uncomfortable because you will have to wear them for extended amounts of time. There's a bunch of different brands, a bunch of different styles. I would ask wherever you're going to buy shoes or look online to see what would be best for you. Beginner shoes are usually ones like this because it's flat and it's very straight. So a lot of shoes you'll get are either really, really curved in like this, or they're super downturned like this. And when they're like this, they're obviously a lot less comfortable. So you want something like flat, wide, and straight to start.
Yeah, thanks so much, Robert. I think it's really cool to kind of see that equipment up close and in person, because a lot of people, are unfamiliar with it, never seen it before. So thank you guys so much for joining us this evening. We really appreciate you taking an hour out of your day to spend with us, learn hopefully a new skill or refresh a skill that maybe you've not done in a while. If you have any follow-up questions, you can respond to the email I'm going to send out to each one of you with the recorded link to rewatch this in case you want to, and with some other things. And if you filled out the sign-in sheet, we'll be mailing you an Outdoor Chattanooga sticker as a thank you for joining us this evening. We hope to see you guys outside in nature soon. I think Robert, you're responding to Buck right now. Okay. I won't end it until you get that sent. Otherwise, Thank you guys, and enjoy the rest of your evening. All right, Buck, hopefully you can copy Robert's email down real quick. And I can also include it in the email, Buck. That might help as well.
Sure.
Robert, any final parting words before we close this thing out tonight?
Thank you all for coming. I really hope this made you interested in climbing and I didn't just bore you for an hour. If you ever see me at the climbing gym, at the climbing wall, please approach me, say hello, tell me that you saw me through the Outdoor Technica workshop. I always love meeting new people, new climbers, and wouldn't mind helping you out along the way.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Robert. Appreciate you sharing your knowledge with us this evening. And our next virtual workshop will be all about biking on May 4th. Hopefully you guys will join us for that one as well. And we're going to keep this thing rolling until we run out of outdoor activities to share with you all, which is impossible because there's so many. Thank you guys, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Bye.
Bye.